I have never been so happy to be wrong about something. This has been like a reverse Sonic cycle. I fully expected this to be bad and ended up pleasantly surprised. Following this movie through its pre-production, it sounded like it was going to be a flaming bag of dog crap. Live-action Sonic? Jim Carrey as Robotnik? Teaming up with the Cyclops cameo from the X-Men films? Just, oh man, like not a single portion of this sounded like a good idea, outside of, you know, casting Ben Schwartz, but we'll get to that. And then... Holy moly, that design. After I saw that first trailer, there was not a single thing you could tell me to convince me that I would end up enjoying this movie. The pacing in that trailer was so bad. They wasted so much time with this awkward garbage with Robotnik and...
The face, God, the face of nightmares, and Coolio, and... Boy, oh boy.
Now, let's also get this out of the way. This is not a perfect movie. I've been seeing some reviewers saying that this is not Alvin and the Chipmunks or Hop. This is. This absolutely is. We were still right about that. This is still a Sonic-flavored family adventure. But you know what? It's the Sonic portion that really kind of elevates that. Now, look, if you happen to stumble across this and you're not actually a Sonic fan, you're just kind of curious to see if you can take your kid to this and you remember playing the Genesis games, so... Hopefully you won't go insane watching it. I think you're gonna be fine. I personally don't watch a whole lot of movies like Hop and Alvin and the Chipmunks. I've seen some of that stuff and I usually kind of hate it, but you know, when you're raising children, I imagine you just kind of have to accept garbage in your life. This is totally palatable. You're gonna be just fine, I promise you. And you might even get some references. But if you have no connection to Sonic, if you are here simply for the art of cinema, don't watch it. You're not gonna like it. I promise you, you're not gonna like it. And I know that's gonna piss off some Sonic fans, but you're gonna have to deal with that, guys. It's not for people here looking for Oscar-worthy contenders. Like, this isn't Pixar-level quality. It's not. You have to accept that. It's fine that it's not that. This review is not for film buffs. This is for Sonic fans. So if you're not a Sonic fan, clear out. And if you are a Sonic fan and you have not seen the movie yet, turn this off. I've said in post I was going to keep this spoiler free, but I am going to go over a good portion of the beats. I'm not going to reveal anything that is a big surprise, but I mean, YouTube's kind of spoiling this movie already, guys. I've had recommendations that are literally the end credit scene. And I've heard that even the advertisements are kind of spoiling like a really big thing that shows up in the opening minutes of this movie. Just come back later. This will still be here, so get on out of here. And a little more negativity before we get to more positive stuff here. This is being hailed by many to be the best big budget Hollywood movie based off a video game, but look guys, we gotta set the bar a little bit higher than this. This is about right on level with Detective Pikachu, and I didn't think that was like really stellar storytelling, but I believe that movies based off video games can be really stellar storytelling because video games can do that, but you're not gonna find that here, not yet. And I love Sonic, but I expect a little bit more if that's what we're going for when it comes to video game based movies. And yes, I know it sounds like I am hating on this movie. I don't, but if we're talking strictly as a movie, well, you're gonna get really angry if you go to the Movie Bobs or the Your Movie Sucks type of dudes on the internet. They're not gonna like this movie, but again, this video is not for them. If you want my personal opinion, well, Sonic starts things off by saving a turtle. Therefore, it's the best movie ever. I think the movie's totally fine. And the more I think about it, it's better than fine. I think I like it more the more I talk about it. If you're a Sonic fan, you need to see this. Whatever this movie does not do perfectly, you're going to love the elements that it does nail. And like Sonic 1, you can tell these guys are smart enough to learn, refine, and come back with an even better sequel. The movie is at its best when it finally leans into what makes Sonic, well, Sonic. I mean, the product placement is somewhat jarring, and there is a dip in the effects on occasion, especially when James Marsden is lifting up Sonic. It looks like he's just picking up a pile of sticks. You could definitely see the budget limit in this movie, and where they had to pander to make up for the cost of that redesign, or actually probably what it costs to get Jim Carrey into this thing. So I'm willing to forgive some issues with pacing, Olive Garden gift cards, or floss dancing, because this is a cute flick, and I get the impression that with a bigger budget and some acceptance from Paramount and Sega to lean more into the source material, this could end up being quite the movie series. And actually, now that I'm thinking about the product placement, Sonic's shoes are Pumas, and they make a pretty big deal about them in the movie. But guess what? You can't buy them anywhere. Even though they're
I guess, making special editions of the shoes. They made this really fancy YouTube video for it, and there's only like 5 pairs of them, and you can't buy them. What are you doing, Sega? Who's Puma? I don't know. Who am I yelling at here? Just let me give you money. I don't even like red. I just want those shoes. Just give me the damn shoes, Sega. You know they didn't even make shoes when they partnered with Soap for Sonic Adventure 2? Why are they so weird about this? Are you worried we're gonna emulate Sonic's fashion to the T? Run around in nothing but shoes and gloves? Because that's what a real Sonic man would do, you cowards. Also, while I'm on this tangent, what's with this fast food tie-in? Tiny Tacos at Jack in the Box. That clearly was the most logical partnership to make. Sega, why do you make it so hard to let me give you money? I don't know. This is not even about the movie. I just think the marketing of this thing was, I mean, it just looks desperate. It's kind of hilarious. Sega certainly isn't the name it used to be. Just, oh boy. Well, back to the movie itself. Like I said, Sonic saves a turtle, and then immediately afterwards talks about this mushroom world he might have to go to and how much he hates mushrooms. So he's clearly poking fun at Mario, right? That's not too much of a coincidence. That's gotta be a Mario reference. Am I crazy? That's the first thing I thought of. Then look, I'm ride or die for Sonic, but come on, man. That console war was fought valiantly, but pretty thoroughly lost. Sonic throwing any shade Nintendo's way is about as effective as flying around a Confederate flag and declaring the South will rise again. Comparing Sonic to the Confederate Army, I'm sure that's gonna go over smoothly with everyone. We're in for quite the review. What am I doing? All right, look, I thought even for a family flick, they could have tightened things up in spots, but ultimately they did a commendable job making Sonic work in the real world. But I ask the same question I've been asking since I was a kid. Why does this franchise insist on trying so hard to stuff this hedgehog into the real world? The most interesting portion of the movie is right at the beginning in Sonic's home world. And again, I tried to keep away from ads and scenes that they were throwing up online, so I knew Baby Sonic was in there, but I was like, okay, who is this bird? And then you see what forces Sonic out of his world and into ours, and man, it is just the biggest tease. Like, why are we going to Earth? I want to know what's going on with this. I want to know what's going on with that thing. Can we stay here? Please? No? Just gonna hang out with James Marsden. Damn it. So Sonic has been hanging out in one town for like 10 years, making a home for himself, and staying hidden from the human world. And he's lonely. He has all this energy and wit, and is clearly a younger take on the character, but this has to be torture for someone as outgoing as Sonic. He just sort of watches people in town live out their lives without being able to interact with them. Watching movies through windows, or baseball games through the holes in seats. He even has to talk to himself to keep himself company. Sort of reminded me of another character quite obsessed with rings. Now, I could not stop thinking about how creepy these scenes would be with that first design of movie Sonic. Those comic strips weren't too far off, were they? From there, Sonic is playing with himself, phrasing, on a baseball field. He gets upset for being alone and ends up running until he lets off a massive wave of energy that knocks power out of the entirety of the northwestern portion of the US. You guys thought Archie Sonic was OP? Well, Ogilvy Murray's hedgehog has nothing on movie Sonic. A single quill of his apparently has unlimited power. Good golly. From there, the movie starts kicking off. The US government brings in Robotnik to investigate and, look, I'll be frank with you guys. Jim Carrey does a solid job, but he is still just Jim Carrey. He doesn't shape a personality around a character. The character has to conform to his zany attitude. And you know what? I get it. There have been so many iterations of Robotnik's character. He has been silly as hell, and he has been scary as hell, and everywhere in between. They deviate away from both classic Robotnik and modern Eggman pretty hard, but I mean, what's that even mean? At the end of the day, he's still a good foil for Ben Schwartz Sonic, who I have always said was a solid choice. Despite all my other misgivings about this movie going into it, I'm glad I was not wrong about Ben. He did a fantastic job, not only bringing Sonic to life, but a younger version of Sonic. He's an excitable kid who does not know his own potential. He knows how to run, so he runs away from his problems, but eventually he learns he is far more effective when he runs towards the problem. You see him grow, and as he does, we see him becoming more and more confident, becoming more, well, Sonic. Well, from there he meets Tom. Tom, the human buddy played by James Marsden, and wacky hijinks ensue. Robotnik realizes they're in cahoots and gives chase. Then Sonic and Tom end up at the Salty Spittoon, and everything's just kind of terrible for a little while. Sorry guys, I hated this scene. I did not like it at all. This is the most Alvin and the Chipmunks this movie gets for the entire thing. And kids are gonna love it. I heard kids in the theater just giggling their butts off. It does its job effectively, but I'm not a little kid. I'm not saying you're gonna hate it, and I completely understand if you disagree with me here. They still have fun with what they're doing. Kind of roll my eyes about how badly disguised Sonic is, but I mean, they even make a joke about it, reminding you, like, it's fine, this is a dumb kids movie, have fun, you cranky old man. Anyway, they hit the road from there, and then they have that awesome scene with Robotnik's tank. Then Sonic gets blown up, and then it looks like he's gonna die, but of course he doesn't die. And then they try that crap again at the end of the movie, but like, I don't know why this franchise keeps trying to fake out Sonic's death, like, that's ever been an actual concern. Like, have you seen some of the games this series has produced? Like, nothing's gonna kill Sonic. I mean, the real world has tried so many times. Like, he's not going anywhere. You're stuck with him. So it's around this point where Robotnik discovers that Sonic's hair is just really potent stuff. And I gotta say, I love that we get to see Robotnik actually be a scientist. He takes the quill and runs it through tests, and eventually it just weeds into like a Jim Carrey dance scene. I think he just kind of got bored, and they just kind of kept the cameras rolling. The dude's more of a cartoon character than Sonic, and I bet I was the very first person to ever say that. I bet nobody else reviewing this movie has said that even one time. I am super original, guys. I really want to be more critical of Jim's take on the character, but I just can't. It's impossible not to love him. And this really is a situation where I like this Robotnik the more I talk about him. This scene really shows you the merger between classic Carrie and, well, the evil scientist. And most importantly, he has to work when facing off against Sonic, and he absolutely does. And as for James Marsden as Tom, well, he's inoffensive. He's mostly just there, but he's a charming enough guy. I like him. And I like his wife. No idea what's going on with that sister-in-law. I mean, she keeps telling her to divorce the guy. Is that because movies just aren't allowed to have healthy relationships? Why does this freak her out so much? Seriously, Tom seems to have a very stable relationship. That's never an issue at all, and thank God it's not. Goodness gracious. He's just a super likable dude. The human element I thought was gonna be the worst part of it, but it's perfectly serviceable. That said, I kinda hope we never see him again if we get another movie in this franchise. A lot of this movie, I actually never need to see again. But at the same time, it made me wanna see so much more. I want a Sonic 1 to Sonic 2 situation here. The first game is great and started things off on the right foot, but now that we have streamlined levels and spin dashes, not much reason to go backwards. And I'd really like that with a second Sonic movie. We got to see Sonic become Sonic, and that was a lot of fun, but now I just kind of want to see Sonic be Sonic. And yeah, a big pivotal moment that brought us to that point was Sonic getting his shoes. And yes, since they are Pumas, that does mean this is a product placement. But man, that really does bring the look together. And after that, Sonic and Robotnik finally face off, and it's just so satisfying from then on out. Like I said, I'm fine with Jim Carrey's take on the character because he plays off well against Sonic. The adversarial relationship had to work between these two characters, and it does beautifully. Sonic finally starts talking, again, like Sonic. And I even got goosebumps when he called him Eggman. I grew up calling this guy Robotnik, and they did a full-on Sonic adventure here. His name is Robotnik, but Sonic refuses to show him any sort of respect and calls the guy Eggman, and that works for me. Robotnik's descent into madness makes me believe that in another movie, he will accept the name and even embrace it. And yeah, look, Easter eggs are great, surprise cameos are fantastic, but none of this movie would work if Sonic and Robotnik did not work. And they do. They really, truly do. I know this is a fairly safe family movie. This is baby's first action flick. And I can see where critics are not gonna enjoy it, but I don't care, man. I came into this as a Sonic fan. I've spent most of my time knowing of its existence, expecting to hate this thing. And yes, I was bored in spots, questioning logic in others, but I left the theater believing that Sonic works in movies. It left me wanting much more. And again, the more I talk about it, the more I like it. So there you go, guys. That's where this Sonic fan lands on this movie. I've only been sitting on it for a day, but I can tell that regardless of the flaws, I'm gonna like this the more I think about it. And that rarely happens when I start picking apart a movie. There's a lot of dedication to what makes Sonic Sonic, and maybe it's not a perfect movie, and maybe we need to do better as video game movies as a whole, but this was a lot of fun, and if you want to know what I think about it compared to Detective Pikachu, I mean, this
person.
I enjoy this way more than Detective Pikachu, for whatever that's worth. This really comes down to what franchise you adore more, but as far as the two leads are concerned, it's hard to compete with Ryan Reynolds, but I love that this movie does not need to turn the iconic character into Ryan Reynolds. They got Ben Schwartz because they believed that he would do a brilliant job bringing Sonic, the character, to life, and he did. Yes, they went for star power with the villain, but I mean, that's where you can get a little bit more wild and creative, and even then, Jim being Jim, you could tell that he was trying, like, real hard, like, he was really going for it, and that's great as well. I'm fine with the use of the rings. I know we didn't have Chaos Emeralds, but, like, for general public, if you gotta get any doohickey in there, you gotta get the rings in there. Chaos Emeralds can happen later on. Using them as portals? Fine. The movie kind of breaks apart when you realize that Sonic is super duper quick, so he can go anywhere really quickly, and even then he has instant transportation with his rings, and the movie does its best to explain why he doesn't use those immediately to solve all of his problems. Still, the more I think about this movie, the more it makes me think about Sonic, the franchise as a whole, and more specifically, where it goes from here, but that's for another time. We still have a marathon to finish, so I'm gonna get back to work on that. So, until next time, toot toot, Sonic Warriors.